Dear neighbor, I was sincerely sorry to hear a loved one so near to you was killed in Vietnam. Experience and years has taught me there is nothing I can say that will ease the sorrow. However, you took me to task for urging my son to go to war. I would clarify that. I do not urge anyone to go to war. I sincerely hope there is an unequivocal end to war. I only pointed out to my son I cannot tolerate a shirker. Being born in this country starts an individual out with advantages, in my estimation, that demand recompense. John Kennedy said, "Ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country." I didn't even advocate my son do the asking. I only informed him if his country asked something of him within reason, he should answer. I feel protecting our freedom is well within reason. You ask me how I would feel if, because of my strict convictions, my son went to war and was killed. How do you answer a question like that? I know if he was killed drag racing or in a speeding automobile, I would feel I had failed him. By my example and love-tainted tolerance, I had failed to convince him of the importance of living by the rules. The same would hold true if he was killed in an attempted commitment of any felony. I also know if he was killed while experimenting with drugs, I would spend the rest of my life in the hell of knowing I had not given him the strength to accept reality. If my son was killed as a looter during a riot, I would live my life to eternity with a gaping, unanswered why in my mind. But you ask me how I would feel if he was killed while fighting for his country, protecting principles I was instrumental in teaching him, principles he must have felt had value enough to gamble his life to ensure their continuance. There is no way I can tell you how I would react to an indescribable tragedy in my life. However, I can tell you this. Some of the tears would be from the pride in my heart that swelled and overflowed in my eyes. Self-appointed, self-righteous, self-opinionated, censorious do-gooders, do me a favor. Keep your scissors in your sewing basket, your bustles out of the bookstores, your mitts off the magazines, your mind out of the movies, and your dogma away from my door. Truthfully, do the words filthy, smut, and obscene describe what you read and view, or does it describe your mind? Where do you get your sanctimonious convictions? It is up to you what other people read or see. You have every right to control what your children read or see, just as I do. However, I do not appreciate your attempting to regulate what I or my children read or see. Because if I allow you to censor obscenity on your judgment, when do you begin screening the truth to conform with your beliefs? I'm not speaking of hardcore pornography. With proper sex education and home environment for our children, there wouldn't be the market there is now for pornography. We can only hope, with the so-called sexual revolution, the level-headed truth-seeking youth of today will put the pious self-appointed arbitrator of our moral objectives on the bookshelf in the history section. We hear you scream when there's a movie on television, if a scene or its theme is audacious to your maladjusted moral code. You profess to fear for the harm it could do your children. Most of the television sets I have seen have a knob that changes channels, and even one to turn it off. You are, however, strangely silent when a documentary of television demonstrates violence and brutality. We hear you scream when a movie contains nudity. You are strangely silent when a movie depicts the St. Valentine's Day massacre. If a scene displays more than a glimpse of a lady's breast, it must be cut. Yet a matinee of murder, mayhem, man's inhumanity to man makes a great substitute for a babysitter. You drive great literary works under the counter, yet buy monster comics for the kids by the armful. A toy manufacturer planned to introduce a boy doll complete with sex organs. I assumed this would help teach children at the proper age that boys aren't just girls with muscles. Not to the muckrakers of America. They say the doll is obscene. Yes, Virginia, there is a sickness. Realizing you censorites believe you are saving humanity, consider this suggestion. The next time you feel the urge, fly down to the newsstand and confiscate all the gardening publications. Nobody digs up more dirt than those people, and they have pictures, too. There's an old story that says you can't kill a frog by dropping him in boiling water. He reacts so quickly to the sudden heat that he jumps out before he's hurt. But if you put him in cold water and then warm it up gradually, he never decides to jump until it's too late. By then, he's cooked. Men are just as foolish. Take away their freedom overnight and you've got a violent revolution. But steal it from them gradually, under the guise of security, peace, or progress, and you can paralyze an entire generation. Look at the income tax. It started out at a harmless sounding 1%. It would have been easy to jump out of water as tepid as this. But like the frog, we waited while it climbed ever higher. Try jumping now. And worst of all, we never learn. Even today, we cannot believe that Medicare is the same warm water that will one day boil us in socialized medicine. We see no connection between farm price supports and nationalized agriculture. But if we draw a parallel between subsidized teachers' pay and federal control of education, we are called extremists. The tragedies of history are always repeated by those who refuse to learn them. To seek guidance from the past is not turning the clock back, as we're often told. It is merely a good way to keep out of hot water. To the flower power. A trivial portion of our population, I'm happy to note. If you're attempting to put on the whole world, forget it. Many of the world governments have no sense of humor at all, and ours is getting a little thin. If you're deriving your philosophy from drugs, remember that sooner or later playtime ends and it's time for show and tell. If you're really sincere, then why not find your own Shangri-La? Set up shop and stop attempting to convert the millions of responsible Americans that have already found theirs. To rebel against tyranny is commendable. To rebel against freedom in any form is asinine. As long as you do not keep me from my barber, I have no quarrel with your long hair or beards. As long as I'm not required to spend any time in an enclosed area with you, the same goes for your body hygiene. You profess to believe in free love when it's in private with two consenting adults. Isn't that your kind of bag? However, the freedom you so vigorously seek by your demonstration, that of enjoying the benefits of this country's advantages while refusing to take part in strengthening its structure, is selfish pusillanimity. Make love, not war, you say. From where a lot of people your age are sitting, it doesn't appear that the North Vietnamese want to kiss them. You attempt to imply that people in America like war. I'm forced to admit there are a handful of people in this country that do enjoy wars, but they're a bigger bunch of nuts than you are. I must admit your make love, not war does bring a sick, humorous thought to mind. If everyone in the world could be convinced, when two countries disagreed on anything, They could have a love-in. A panel of impartial judges could select the winner. If you ever should, heaven forbid, convince the majority of this country to practice your policy of make love, not war, it would be only a matter of time before the communists would be telling you to make all the love you want right after a 10-hour gig in the salt mines. If you refuse to face up to reality that life consists of a little more give than take, if you refuse to contribute anything more to our society than your blooming philosophy, consider this. There must be an uncharted island somewhere, covered with flowers and void of soap and razors. So please, be my guest. Dear son, you ask my reaction to long hair or beards on young people. Some great men have worn long hair and beards, George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. If to you long hair or a beard is a symbol of independence, if you believe in your heart that the principles of this country, our heritage, is worthy of this display of pride that all men shall remain free, that free men at all times will not inflict their personal limitations of achievement on others, to demand your own rights as well as the rights of others and be willing to fight for this right, you have my blessing. You ask that I not judge you merely as a teenager, to judge you on your own personal habits, abilities, and goals. This is a fair request, and I promise I will not judge any person only as a teenager, if you will constantly remind yourself that some of my generation judges people by their race, their belief, or the color of their skin, and that this is no more right than saying all teenagers are drunken dope addicts or glue sniffers. If you will judge every human being on his own individual potential, I will do the same. You ask me if God is dead. This is a question each individual must answer within himself. Could a warm summer day, with all its brightness, all its sound, all its exhilarating breathiness, just happen? God is love. Remember that God is a guide and not a stormtrooper. Realize that many of the past and present generation, because of a well-intentioned but unjustifiable misconception, have attempted to legislate morality. This created part of the basis for your generation's need to rebel against our society. With this knowledge, perhaps your children will never ask, is God dead? I sometimes think much of mankind is attempting to work him to death. You ask my opinion of draft card burners. I would answer this way. All past wars have been dirty, unfair, immoral, bloody, and second-guessed. However, history has shown most of them necessary. If you doubt that our free enterprise system in the United States is worth protecting, if you doubt the principles upon which this country was founded, that we remain free to choose our religion, our individual endeavors, our method of government, if you doubt that each free individual in this great country should reap rewards commensurate only with his own efforts, then it's doubtful you belong here. If you doubt that people to govern us should be selected by their desire to allow us to strive for any goal we feel capable of attaining, then it's doubtful you should participate in their selection. If you are not grateful to a country that gave your father the opportunity to work for his family, to give you the things you've had, and you do not feel pride enough to fight for your right to continue in this manner, then I assume the blame for your failure to recognize the true value of our birthright. Now, I would remind you that your mother will love you no matter what you do, because she is a woman. And I love you too, son. But I also love our country and the principles for which we stand. If you decide to burn your draft card, then burn your birth certificate at the same time. From that moment on, I have no son.
Dear parents, if you're attempting to point an accusing finger at the rebellious youth of today, you might practice in front of a mirror. If you want to go in for some honest soul searching, you might answer truthfully. Are you helping your children to grow up or just allowing it to happen? Disrespect for the law is not an inborn trait. Realizing that example is one of the top teaching methods, how about these for openers? The highest court in the land ruled it unconstitutional to compose and prescribe prayers in schools. Clear-thinking Americans of all faiths could see the wisdom in this decision, and yet because of the fear of the dogmatic Christian fright peddlers refusing to separate church and state, many of our public schools completely ignore this Supreme Court decision. Could this give any ideas to our youth? The very lawmakers of our country, congressmen, play a little under-the-table roulette and get off with a censure and a little bad publicity. We can only hope this isn't the ingredient that attracts our youth to politics. Labor union heads defy orders, sanction violence, tamper with our courts, and literally get away with murder. Is this the strength in numbers we advocate to our youth? We as parents defy traffic regulations, ignore anti-litter legislation, express fear and contempt for law enforcement officers. Then we're amazed when youth refer to them as cops, bulls, or the fuzz. If you would like to test your method of rearing your children, ask your child why he doesn't steal. If he says because it's against the law, you've got a smart child. If he answers because it's wrong, you know you're on the right track. If you're relying on babysitters, teachers, and law enforcement agencies to raise your children, believe me, they cannot be blamed for a failure. Even the best of the great of these cannot add the necessary magical ingredients, love and understanding. If rebellion, lawlessness, and disrespect are not hereditary, why do parents and voters feel they must look any further than the end of their nose? The back end for the source of today's problems. A man's hands, building his home, raising a flag, petting a dog, burning a flag. A man's hands, hiding his face, saying goodbye, making two fists, pointing up high. A man's hands, shaking his friend's hand, saving a life, digging a grave, picking tomatoes. A man's hands, holding his son, aiming a gun, teasing a woman, killing a man. A man's hands, over his head, folded in prayer, shackled in shame, nailed on a cross. God motivates them, the devil takes them, the hands of a man. The hands of a man. This is a work I received from an ex-Marine in Phoenix, Arizona. I died for you today, my friends, in the slime of Vietnam. And if you're concerned, to say the least, I'll tell you who I am. I'm the soldier and the sailor. I'm the airman and marine. I'm the lifeblood of your nation. You have sent me to this scene. I'm the one who loads the Amtraks. I'm the pilot just as well. I'm the dedicated corpsman saving leathernecks who fell. I'm the trooper of the airborne. I'm the CB with a trade. I'm the tireless army medic, dodging steel to give first aid. I'm the gunner in the choppers. I'm the crew chief in the crew. I'm the cannoneer and mortar man in the field defending you. I'm the men of different races clinging to a rumbling tank. I'm Catholic, Jew, and Protestant, and I serve in every rank. Call me Cohen, Smith, or Kelly, or pronounce my foreign name. Regardless of my color, when I'm hurt, I bleed the same. I'm Indian and Mexican. I'm Polish, Dutch, and Greek. But I'm every inch American, and your freedom's what I seek. I came from every walk of life, from mansions to the slums. I've seen the bell of liberty, and I've heard the fife and drums. I'm the rancher and the miner. I'm the farmer from the plain. I've lived by God through dust and drought, and I've prayed aloud for rain. I've known hardship and depression, still I've seen our country grow. When Uncle Sam came calling, I was proud that I could go. Now I've watched those demonstrations and the marchers who protest, and I said, thank God for freedom. Why, my country is still the best. So take your banners and your slogans, raise your placards to the sky, and I'll defend your right to do it. Though in doing so, I'll die. I'm your father's sons and brothers. I'm the arm of Uncle Sam. And I died today for you, my friends, in the slime of Vietnam.
In Vietnam. It isn't an easy task. In fact, with the actions of some of my countrymen, it isn't easy being an American, even in America. By today's standards, it may be important to some of you to know I am a white American. To many, this factor must be known before they can judge my ability and worth. You know, men get close in war. Two of my men were killed just a day apart by snipers. Enemy snipers, not rioting neighbors. I found a letter on the second boy's body he'd written to his congressman, and I thought its contents might help you select the next color scheme in your judgment of man. Dear sir, I'm writing to you because I have no mother and father, and my chaplain agreed there was an outside chance you could help. Now, I didn't vote for you because I'm not old enough, but if you can help me, I promise I will when I'm 21. My buddy Carl got himself killed yesterday. He was a great guy, sir. He never did anything great that you'd ever hear about, but he was my friend. He saved my life three times, but that's not why he's my friend. It was because he was a man that cared. Carl and I talked a lot. Except when we were pinned down in a mud hole and both too scared to talk. We planned to do things together when we got home, like trying to do something about all the hate and the lawlessness in our hometown. Carl used to say, Jeff, it isn't all the people, it's hoods, bigots, and hate mongers. and he said people were trying to replace moral obligation with legislation, and the credibility gap between man, his God, and his conscience was widening. Carl was a smart man. He was my friend. And I'd like to apologize for the water spots on this letter. It isn't raining. I just loved my friend. Sir, Carl and I hope that if we got killed over here, we'd get together in heaven. And he worried about maybe with all the hate and prejudice on earth, heaven might be segregated. And we discussed the futility of you people attempting to legislate morality. But just in case, would you do me a favor? Introduce a bill to integrate heaven. I honestly believe I'll go to heaven when I die. But I don't want to go if my friend is not there. And he felt that if God could condemn a whole race of people because of the beliefs and actions of a few, he might have a problem getting in. You see, sir, my buddy Carl was white.
Those that would be democracy's executioner. What have you programmed for the future? By abusing the very rights you inherited, you attempt to make a sham of them all. To the few, quote, Americans, unquote, that attempt to divide and conquer the rest of us with their posy passive resistance, don't push too hard. If you really do not care to fight, then perhaps you should be ready to run. To the subversives in this country that, for reasons best known to themselves, believe that communist rule is more appealing, don't push your luck. You haven't made the penetration in this country your leaders would have you believe. Wave a flag at us and every hand reaches the left breast, mainly in prideful observance. Only one in a million is searching for a match in their shirt pocket. To the white supremacy bigot and the militant black power and your attempts to make the rest of us see red, you only infect more of us with color blindness. And to the law lords of enslavement, we may only grumble slightly when you legislate away little points of free enterprise and private desires. But don't book any bets, we won't erupt. If you trespass in our voting booth or on our right to protect our homes and families. To the give it all away but mine, socialistic share the wealth advocates. How much do you have to get kicked in the ghettos before you see the impotence of your seduction of votes? Do you believe what you believe? Or does the following quotation hit you where you live part-time? The lessons of history show conclusively that continued dependence upon relief induces a spiritual and moral disintegration fundamentally destructive to the national fiber. To dole out relief is to administer a narcotic, a subtle destroyer of the human spirit. The federal government must and shall quit this business of relief. End of quote. The man that made that statement was Franklin Roosevelt in 1935, but I doubt it is in any of our history books. And to all of you that are intentionally or unintentionally attempting to undermine the foundation of our country, I would say this. My son wrote a report in high school, and in it noted, "Beware, for your enemy will not come in force. Rather, he's already upon you." And he's only one of millions of teenagers who do not divorce themselves of reality. As I look around me, there is trouble in our country, but our country is not in trouble.